Okay, so it is 3 o'clock. Jane, should we? Great. So why doesn't everyone take their seats? We have here. We are getting into the nitty gritty. So you are all to be congratulated for staying around for where the rubber meets the road here at 3 o'clock.
There will be a quiz.
We have a panel of experts who have. Many of whom I know who have for the last, over the last decade, and particularly over the last 5 years, worked intensively with states on a range of issues to think about their individual and coordinated response to energy and environmental challenges. This panel is going to focus on jurisdictions and implementation. 111D involves a number of competing jurisdictions, both the ISOs, FERC, the state utility commissions, the state environmental commissions, and we're going to hear from these panelists about their work they've done in the past and what they see looking forward. Vicki Arroyo is the executive director of the Georgetown Climate Center in Washington, D.C. She has worked with REGI states, WCI states, and everything in between. And is a close and trusted partner of those states and will share with us some of her conversations. We have Commissioner Jim Gardner of Kentucky, which is a, I'm not gonna describe the hue of Kentucky with respect to 111, but maybe we're going to hear that it is more colorful of a state than one might initially expect on this issue. Matt Stanberry of Advanced Energy Economy, the work that is going on with advanced energy companies as a trade association of companies in digital energy and new energy businesses to find innovative ways to meet the building block standards. And then finally, Mike Gergen, who is both a partner at Latham and Watkins Energy Practice and also a beloved adjunct professor here at NYU. And he will talk about jurisdictional conflict among the four building blocks, the ways in which different jurisdictions may affect how those building blocks take shape within the states. So to get us started, we're gonna each talk for 10 or 15 minutes or so, and then we'll have a good, robust Q&A session, and I hope you'll all join with me in peppering the panelists with your thoughts. So Vicki, why don't you lead off?
Do you want us to come up?
Why don't you? Yeah, that'd be great.
Great to be here. Thank you so much, NYU, for the invitation. It's really a delight to come up to New York and thank the hearty people who are still here. I was telling Tim Perfetta that maybe the best thing we could do for climate change is go out in our suits and do a flash mob in the square and try to get people's attention to the issue, as opposed to me saying what Jackson and Jared and others have already said. So I will not use my whole 15 minutes. I'm just going to look through my notes and see what hasn't been covered so that we can get into a conversation. Part of that is to hopefully just make you aware of some resources that you can look up on your own time. Our Climate Center, as you've heard, has actually been working quite a bit with the states, doing some convenings on this issue. We were set up over 5 years ago to inform the federal dialogue in Washington on climate and energy policy with the lessons of the states and to serve as a resource to the states on these issues. And we work on the major sectors that emit carbon and reducing emissions from transportation as well as the electric power generation sector. And we also do a lot of work on adaptation to the inevitable consequences of climate change. So in the 111D context, within a couple of days of President Obama's speech on climate last summer at Georgetown, we had a convening of a number of states, not only what you would think of as leadership states, but other states as well, who I think just want to play a constructive role in this arena, as well as power companies. And from that, and from some other subsequent convenings that we continue to have, one coming up in December, we've done some reports that you might be interested in, including capturing some of the success stories of reducing carbon emissions from this important sector by states and power companies that really have achieved reductions in the order of, you know, what's being called for here moving forward, or even more in some cases. So you can look that up on our website. We've also facilitated a smaller group of state officials, 15 in fact, who sent a letter of EPA to EPA before the proposal came out with general support and a framework that informed the proposal, and that group is still convening to talk about the proposal and comments on that, and we'll be considering some of the new information that came out just today. We've also developed resources to really assist the broader group of states and stakeholders, a rule summary, recorded webinar presentations, sort of walking people through the rule for those of you who missed this morning's excellent session, and a summary of all the issues on which EPA is asking comment. And finally, we have a state energy analysis tool so that you can go in and look state by state at what the states have already achieved in terms of carbon reductions, renewable energy, what's the generation mix, and how the carbon intensity has changed over time. So those might be useful to you. Just a couple of high-level points. The clean power plans flexibility, I think it's clear from all the discussions today, allows states the opportunity to address the jurisdictional issues that we're going to talk about through a variety of mechanisms. It gives states broad flexibility over a long time frame to design state plans that accommodate their existing climate and energy programs, can address reliability concerns, and achieve emission reductions cost effectively. Beyond the four building blocks, as you've heard, the states can decide how to meet the goals, and some of the ways that they could do that would be building new efficient combined cycle natural gas plants, using co-firing with natural gas at existing coal plants, upgrading aging transmission infrastructure for greater efficiency, implementing more efficient appliance standards or building codes, integrating power sector planning processes into state plans, and the list goes on and on. We've already talked a lot today about rate versus mass based approach, and that gives more flexibility to allow cap and trade programs like REGI to continue to count. And it's important that the EPA, though, is building on a portfolio of measures that many states are taking, not just the states in this region, but a number of states that are already shifting generation away from coal, states like Colorado, Tennessee, Illinois, Arkansas, Maryland, Arizona, Oregon, and more. Importantly, they recognize that the electricity system is interstate in nature, and that electricity flows across state lines and promote cross-state collaboration, whether it be formal through REGI or other processes that you've already heard about from people like Jackson and Jared, or more informally. And we and others, including Tim Profeta, who was here earlier from the Nicholas Institute, and certainly others, including Bill Ritter in Colorado, are facilitating dialogues of states, not necessarily because they're going to formally join, but because they just feel like sharing information with your neighbors makes a lot of sense, trying to figure out what to do about some of those seams issues that you heard about today. States and regions are already demonstrating how energy and environmental programs can bridge jurisdictional divides and work together. Individual states are already addressing some of these issues in their energy and climate programs. State energy and environmental regulators have been working together on renewables, efficiency, and budget trading programs in the past and achieving real reductions cost effectively. So, for example, Colorado's Clean Air, Clean Jobs Act, enacted by the state legislature in 2010, requires utilities to develop multi-state plans to reduce air pollution emissions from dirtier power plants. A 29% emission reduction by 2018 is anticipated. And the development of this act was through dialogue with utilities, environmental groups, the natural gas industry, and a bipartisan group of state officials. They also have a strong renewable energy standard, 30% by 2020. They have a strong energy efficiency standard, and the list goes on. So these state programs already are taking coordination between different state agencies, and all of them could be used as compliance strategies under EPA's Clean Power Plan. Everybody knows California's been a leader with AB 32. And there again, while CARB designed and administers the multi-sector cap and trade program, CPUC oversees the electric utility compliance with these requirements. CPUC and the Energy Commission jointly implement California's ambitious RPS, which requires 33% of total energy procurement of renewables by 2020. States like Arkansas have been implementing rules, working closely together. Their Department of Environmental Quality has been working with their PUC, having a very engaging stakeholder process. They have 21 representative stakeholders from environmental groups, utilities, co-ops, the health department, meeting, having these day-long meetings to talk about the rule and how they might comply. You heard Joel this morning mention Montana and the white paper issued by the governor, and a recent editorial in Billings said, why wouldn't we want to promote things like energy efficiency in our state? So I think it's just important to realize that it's not just these states that we're familiar with often on the coast, but a lot of states are really taking a hard look at how they can meet this, building on the work of what they've been doing. You've heard a lot about Reggie and his leadership in Cap and Invest, which has been successful, and the revenues and the proceeds that have been plowed back here. But one of the things to keep in mind is that Reggie is served by different ISOs or RTOs. It's served by ISO New England. New York has its own ISO. Delaware and Maryland are served by the PJM interconnection. So it shows that these kind of relationships are possible, even where there is sort of some kind of networking that you have to do across your own RTO. Other states are working within their RTO footprint, and you heard that the MISO region from the Midwest, and actually that goes down South Central to Louisiana, where I'm from. They have the Mid-Continent States Energy and Environmental Regulators that's bringing together regulators within MISO's footprint, taking a real no-regrets approach, trying to figure out how they can work together, data sharing and all of that. So states do have relationships based on where the electricity flows to, and the structure of the rule incentivizes working to take advantage of the benefits of this kind of interstate renewable and efficiency opportunity. Jonathan just asked us to talk a little bit about trends that we're seeing in our state conversations, either issues or concerns, and maybe offering some solutions. So I'll just mention a few, and we can have more during the discussion. Everybody keeps talking about rate versus mass, and that really apparently wasn't resolved by the guidance coming out today, but we do anticipate that EPA will be coming out with that shortly. Many states are probably going to be interested in complying using a mass-based emission budget based on what we've heard today. So translating that will be very helpful. We realize it's complex, but EPA guidance is really important. We've heard some uncertainty from state officials on jurisdictional issues, what different agencies can play. So for example, there's some concern that regulations might infringe on a PUC's authority to administer or regulate demand-side efficiency programs. How enforceable is that if that's part of the complement of strategies that a state submits to EPA? Will the feds come in and swoop down and make you implement efficiency later? How would this be enforceable? We've been discussing a state commitment approach that would include some kind of contingency or backstop measures that the states could submit that would actually come into play if the standard is not achieved. There are some practical implementation issues that we're discovering, in part because of the flexibility in the plan. So, we went from helping to generate this letter for the states to say that they wanted flexibility, but of course with flexibility comes a lot of choices and some concern that maybe the choices that you make will not be okay with EPA. So there is a sense of trying to get a bit more guidance and also trying to figure out how the states might work together, maybe not by joining something like Reggie per se, or having a joint plan, which is also incentivized under the EPA proposal, but figuring out other ways that they can maybe link markets, and Jackson talked a little bit about that. So again, in our work with states, we're trying to get a little bit more concrete with this and shift to helping the states envision what these options look like, how the variety of compliance approaches could work in practice, and the policy considerations and design decisions they'll need to make going forward. So this is just a proposal, of course. We're still getting feedback and information from EPA, even as people are trying to generate the comments, so we're interested in taking a look at that. And there are still a number of questions, of course, about what the final rule will look like. But in general, I think it's safe to say that the flexibility built into the Clean Power Plan provides an opportunity for states, if they choose to step back, examine the energy system that is in their states, in their region, and to work with their own state agencies and neighboring states to design the programs that work for them. Thanks.
Thank you, Vicki.
So now by design, we're going to go from that overview of what's happening across the states to one specific state, almost in the middle of the country, or farther west than I usually get, Kentucky.
Thank you. It's a privilege to be here at the Institute for Policy Integrity in NYU. In the 80s, I served two terms on the Lexington City Council. In the 90s, I was chair of the school board in Lexington when we dealt with redistricting, and now I'm on the Public Service Commission. So even though I've practiced law for 30 years, public service and thinking about public service and integrity in public policy has always been part of my DNA, so I appreciate the opportunity to participate here. Also, I have a niece who graduated from the law school here with a master's in tax law. I have a niece who is right now working on her MBA right across the street at Stern School, so I'm going to when we're done, I'm going to get to see her. So I feel some connection to NYU as well. What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about Kentucky. I'm going to talk a little bit about Kentucky utilities. I'm going to talk then and sort of drill down onto what's been happening on the ground in Kentucky. And then I'm going to deal with some of the specific policy issues that we were asked to address. In Kentucky, it's late fall, so people are passionate this year about two things, Kentucky basketball and the EPA. One is positive and one is negative. Guess which? All you have to do is turn on the TV, and if you're in Kentucky, you would have already watched the scrimmage on TV. It's so popular. And the ads are getting flooded by our Senate candidates, mm-hmm. Mitch McConnell and Allison Grimes. And the contest appears to be who hates the EPA and Obama the most, and who supports coal the most. So that at that level, that's about half the ads. And so that's what Kentucky's like this fall. The utilities, we regulate 16 GNTs. We regulate 19 distribution co-ops, which is unusual for a public service commission to regulate co-ops. We have three utilities that are in PJM, one RTO. We have one utility that's in another RTO, MISO. We have TVA in Kentucky. Our two largest utilities are not in any RTO. For those of you who know FERC rules, FERC Order 1000, those two largest utilities are participating in what's called SERTEP, which is a Southeast regional group where they have to cooperate. That includes the Southern Company. So I dare say that there's not too many states that have so many different sort of overlapping issues as Kentucky does. Now let me talk about the chronology of what we've been dealing with. Even before the Clean Power Plan came out, Kentucky's Energy and Environment Cabinet, led by Dr. Lynn Peters, who is a Democrat, appointed by a Democratic governor, proposed a white paper. And for those of you who were engaged in the process a year ago, know that Kentucky's white paper really came out early, and it really did inform a lot of the discussion that occurred pre the rule. And just a couple of the points that it emphasized. One of the things it emphasized was flexibility. Give the states the authority to do it. As Deng Xiaoping said, it doesn't matter what color the cat is, as long as it can catch the mouse. So that's what Kentucky's policy was, be flexible. We emphasized how important manufacturing was to Kentucky, so keeping electricity rates low. The legislature, so it was consider outside of the fence line, consider everything. The legislature was not happy with the white paper that was submitted by the Energy Environment Cabinet. So even before the plan came out in January of this year, the legislature unanimously passed a bill, House Bill 388, that said that Kentucky's plan can only consider inside the fence line. So heat rate improvements at the plant, can't consider anything else, can't do trading, that's it. So it was basically a statement in support of coal, and it was to the extent, and then it was also to rely on litigation as the sole strategy. So that was before the rule came out. The rule came out in July. Lo and behold, many of the concepts that Kentucky's white paper suggested were included in the rule, such as flexibility, such as looking outside of the fence line. Kentucky's, to just give you the complete flavor of it, Kentucky's Attorney General, who is the consumer advocate, has been an outspoken critic of the Clean Power Plan. He's a Democrat. He's running for governor next year. At the commission, here's how we've been dealing with this sort of mixed signals from public policy folks. We appointed a team. We have meetings with the Energy and Environment Cabinet every 2 weeks to talk about it, to see what makes sense for Kentucky, to try to understand it. We've had all invited in all our utilities. We've invited in the RTOs to come talk to us. We've had experts come in, although he's not here now, but we've had folks from the Nicholas Institute come talk to us. We've asked questions directly of Gina McCarthy in meetings. We've had telephone conferences with other experts. We've met with EPA and NERC. So it's trying to understand the rule and also figure out what our comments can mean. So this is in spite of, again, the overall, which is we can't submit a plan that would pass muster in this. So the three primary areas that we on the commission feel that we wanted to make sure that the cabinet, when they submitted their plan, included were, in recent years, we have, at the utility's request, have approved billions of dollars of retrofits for MATS compliance and CASPER compliance. So our thought is, and it extended the useful life of these facilities. So is it fair? It's almost like a detrimental reliance. We relied on you all, EPA, to allow ratepayers to upgrade these facilities for other rules, and now you're gonna shorten the life of that. So we wanted to make sure that reliability and stranded assets were covered in Kentucky's comments. Second, and it's already been talked today here about energy efficiency measurements. What EPA will say about energy efficiency measurements will likely inform what happens in the states going forward. And we wanted to have clarity in energy efficiency measurements. Again, these are just the issues that we at the commission wanted to make sure were included. And then as I was talking with earlier, there's a concern about economic dispatch and how, is it going to be environmental dispatch? What does it mean? With the RTO, what does it mean that PJM, REGI does not include all of PJM? What do you do? Does the price of carbon that REGI sets, is that then going to be the price of carbon that Kentucky would have to use in its economic dispatch? I mean, does Kentucky have to agree to that? I mean, what will another state do? What if you have competing values for carbon? How does that figure out when you're determining what the cost is so you can do economic dispatch in the markets? So we wanted to raise that as an issue that needs some clarification. Kentucky, the target we got is achievable. And Kentucky will be submitting comments. But again, we cannot file a plan that because of House Bill 388, that will meet the EPA target for Kentucky, notwithstanding the fact that the target is potentially achievable. And you say, how is it achievable in Kentucky? Well, we're closing down coal plants. We're converting to natural gas, among other things. So what will happen, of course, is that the feds will submit a plan, likely a FIP, and it'll be much harsher. I mean, we had a jurisdictional question about energy efficiency. Well, it's a question as to whether you can voluntarily do these outside of the fence line things. Can EPA, as was said in the prior panel, you got energy efficiency in there, can they order it? So you've got those jurisdictional issues. So now the topics that I would like to just give a couple final words about. Federal-state relations, I think it's made it worse at some level. We communicate better with FERC and with EPA, but a lot of the state regulators have concerns about federalizing some of the issues that traditionally have been states, such as renewable or energy efficiency. Are those going to be federally enforceable if they're within a plan? Next, will the Clean Power Plan improve reliability? No, it will not improve liability, and maybe 20 years from now it might, but the short answer is it won't, because you're losing all this coal baseload from the dispatch at this point. If you see what the RTOs, what their comments were, the comments they submitted previously in the RTO ISO, everybody's got white papers, RTO ISO white paper, said there needs to be a reliability safety valve. They're really concerned about that. Plus, you know, with gas price volatility and lack of infrastructure for gas when everyone's converting to gas. And then you have renewables with a concern about intermittency. Okay, so final conclusion, two stories. First story is about a half a century ago, and this is to answer one of the policy questions. About a half a century ago, in this neighborhood, a young Minnesotan came and he started singing and playing guitar and all that sort of thing. And he had this word that said, he had this line in one of his early songs that said, "You don't need a weatherman to know which way the wind blows." So one of the questions is, what is a state like Kentucky going to do because of the clean power plan? Well, the reality is Kentucky has already been doing things as if it's there because we could see which way the wind was blowing. We've been much more aggressive the last few years with respect to energy efficiency. We've been approving conversion of coal to gas. The integrated resource plans from utilities are now often including wind. We've got for Kentucky, it's a utility scale solar application in front of us by one of the utilities. So we know which way the wind is blowing. And so Kentucky's portfolio is and will be more diverse. And it's just accelerating that trend that's already existing. And so I have my own belief is that the ultimate, at least in Kentucky, the ultimate form of the rule, whatever happens, whatever survives, is irrelevant because we're already moving there because of the wind. Now, final story, promise. As I said, in my earlier life, I was on the city council. I represented the downtown area, and we had this very low-income neighborhood called Irish Town. There was a road coming from the interstate into Lexington, and it was on the road plan to go through this poor neighborhood. And every now and then it would pop up, and then neighbors and elected people would go crazy. You can't do that. You're going to destroy this neighborhood. You can't do that. So 30 years out, where are we now? The road's gone through, of course, and the neighborhood's gone. Now, how did that happen? Well, it happened because the road plan always contained it. And because of that, even though, you know, somebody would remove it, and the reason is because it was there, there was no investment. So that's what the clean power plan is like. It's out there, it's hanging there, all these EPA regulations are there. We know which way the wind's blowing. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner. We're there's a lot that we're going to come back to, I think, in Q&A. Now, Matt, why don't you talk with us about advanced energy economy and where the wind is blowing?
All right. So we're closing down the day here. So many things have been said, but I'm going to try and tell you a story from maybe a different perspective than what we've heard so far today, and that's from an industry perspective. So I work for Advanced Energy Economy. We represent many of the companies that make the goods, services that can provide emission reductions in the marketplace for the power sector today. And so we have a somewhat maybe unique perspective on the rule and are working at the federal and state levels. We have the fun of working in lots of different states, everywhere from Michigan to Pennsylvania to Arkansas to Arizona and all sorts of places in between and beyond. And so we're getting to hear a number of stories and concerns that are some similarities, some differences in those places. But in order for you to understand, I think, what we're hearing in the states and indeed our perspective on this rule, I want to lay out some context, because I think that's important. 111D, as we've heard in various bits and pieces today, is not happening in a vacuum. There's a lot of other things going on in our electric power system that are really important to consider. So, if it, our if I could summarize, our electric power system has for years now been a engine of economic growth in the United States. But at this day and age, we're starting to see some challenges with that system. There are a number of different challenges lining up. So if I were to take somebody from the 1970s and transplant them into somebody's home or office today, they'd be wowed by the number of technologies that we've got off the shelf. So you've got powerful personal computers, you've got flat screen TVs, you've got smartphones. If you go outside, you've got hybrid vehicles. Some of them are even all electric. If you were to take that same person and take them to our electric system, while there's change, it would look awfully familiar in a lot of ways. And I think that's starting to give us some challenges. So how would I line up those challenges? I'll group them. You've heard about some of them over the course of the day, but I'll try and put them together. So first, we've got an aging system. So the American Society for Civil Engineers does a report card every year on infrastructure. When they looked at the electric power system in their last report card, D+. That looks at electric and natural gas pipeline systems. So we've got an aging system. That contributes to bucket number two. We've got a system with increasing reliability issues underlying it. So if you look at the Eaton blackout tracker, they put out a report every year on outages. 2013, last year of data. We've got over 3,200 outages, up 15% from 2012. And when they looked at estimated cost across the system, across the economy, for outages, surges, and spikes, they estimated those costs were in the order of $150 billion per year to the U.S. economy. Third bucket, we've got changing demands from customers. So we live in a 24/7 culture. We're all overly aware of that, I think. People want more data, they want more control, and they want more choices in today's environment. I think I'd point to data centers as a nice microcosm of that. So data centers, downtime, lost money, right? So a recent study looked at costs for outages number of outages and then cost per outage, comparing 2010 to 2013, again, most recent data. Outages the cost per outage had risen 41% to just under $8,000 a minute. So we've got clear demand from a customer segment for uninterruptible power of really high quality. Finally, we've got, and these have been mentioned a bit today, but they're really, really important, we've got new regulatory requirements on air emissions that have nothing to do with 111D. There's the cross-state rule, NOx and SOx. There's the MATS rule, the mercury, arsenic, and toxics requirements. And then finally, the PM2.5 stringency revisions for NACs, the National Ambient Air Quality Standards. So I think, you know, we've got challenges in four separate buckets there. The good thing is that we've got a lot of technologies and services in the system, they're just not everywhere, that are available to address a number of these challenges. So we've got demand response to increase reliability. We've got natural gas, combined cycle natural gas systems to provide flexible generation that can ramp up and down quickly. We've got solar, wind, a whole suite of renewables that can provide zero cost from a fuel standpoint and zero emission generation. We've got energy efficiency technologies and services that can flatten the demand curve. And we've got smart meters that can give us, again, that better data resolution and more control. So we've got tools there. And so with that as context, we're actually pretty optimistic as an industry about the Clean Power Plan. Why? Well, because we've talked a little bit about the flexibility in the rule today, maybe a lot about. And we see that as a real benefit given this context. So we've got all these challenges to the system, and we've got all these technologies. Well, those technologies happen to, at the same time, an awful lot of them provide emission reductions. We put out a report earlier this year that outlined a range of technologies, 40 different technologies in the power sector that can provide emission reductions. And that was just scratching the surface. All we were trying to do was get the range of available options. There are many, many more. And the key thing to remember is that they're targeted not necessarily at emission reductions. They're designed for other purposes, as I was outlining before. They just happen to also provide these emission reductions. So when we look at the flexibility of the Clean Power Plan as designed in the framework so far, we see opportunity for states to actually invest in essentially accelerating what they're trying to do anyways, which is modernize the electricity system to deal with all of these challenges. And we think that the 111D simply can allow states to accelerate that effort and invest in their systems. And so while we look at the, when we look at the effort to design state plans, we're increasingly starting to see, it's important to think about this from a regulator perspective to the extent that we all can. The flexibility here is different than we find in other types of regulation. So it's not that everybody's sitting there saying, wow, we can solve all these problems. But I think you start to see regulators thinking about pieces of this, how things fit together, some of the air quality standards fitting together, and how you can essentially use your 111D compliance plan to help you with these other environmental regs. But we think about the process of developing plans, and while the planning process might be complex, if you look at this breadth of technologies that are out there and the fact that they address this whole suite of issues for the electric system, and you look at their emission reduction possibilities, and you look at the flexibility the states have to use their own resources within a given state, these targets, actually from a technological perspective, I think maybe to echo what Kentucky's finding, they're imminently achievable from a technological perspective. It's complicated to put a plan together, but you can meet these targets. Quick example, Iowa. If Iowa simply was to take their current rate of wind development, that's about 500 megawatts a year, and just continue that going forward, they'd meet their standard three times over. And you can start to do the math on these pieces in a number of the states. And so we look at this and say, you know, there's a regulatory challenge here in designing the plans, but the targets themselves are achievable. And of course, as mentioned earlier today, the kicker is that when you invest in modernizing your system, you get the economic benefit that goes along with it. Thunder already stolen about the Montana study out of the Department of Environmental Quality, which I think really nicely illustrates that five different scenarios that all provide economic benefit to the state and find that compliance is possible in all of the scenarios. So I think in summary, let me be clear. We look at the Clean Power Plan, we recognize that it's complex. There's regulatory challenges in designing a plan that works. And there's a limited timing window here. We look at the things that are gonna have to be done. They're clearly gonna have to be proceedings in front of commissions. There might have to be legislation in certain states, and there's gonna have to be a lot of policy design that's wider thinking than may have typically been done in certain parts of state government before. But we're seeing states, again, start to put the pieces together of all these challenges in the electric system and start to think about this maybe as an opportunity to sort of kill multiple birds with one stone. And we're obviously encouraging that perspective. We think it's the most cost-effective approach for compliance with 111D and also for meeting the other challenges that the system faces. And with that, I'll turn it back.
Thank you. Thank you, Matt. That's great. So moving from that industry perspective and the multiple paths and missions that regulators currently have at the state level, we want to hear now a little bit about the building blocks themselves and some of the jurisdictional issues. Professor Gergen. And we have some slides.
Since I'm the last of the last, I'm just going to have words.
Be done with this, and great.
Great. Good. So good afternoon, everybody. Last of the last. Everybody take a deep breath. Okay. I have to cover a lot of material here, and we're going to talk electricity, so we're not going to talk environmental. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. Given my day job as an energy regulatory attorney, what I want to talk about are some of the jurisdictional issues and the really challenges associated with implementing the Clean Power Plan as seen from an energy regulatory perspective. These are the four building blocks, and you've heard a lot about them today, and they're just summarized here. And a little shameless self-promotion, this is from a Latham client alert. But we also show the estimates of the cost to abate carbon emissions on an expected dollars per ton abated basis. From an energy regulatory perspective, this proposed framework of compliance building blocks presents a series of jurisdictional issues and challenges because of the complex and multi-jurisdictional energy regulatory structures that underlie our electricity sector, and I think you got a flavor of that from Commissioner Gardner's remarks. But what do I mean by this? Well, as you've already heard, under the Clean Air Act, assuming that EPA has the authority under 111D to regulate carbon emissions from existing power plants, then it has the jurisdiction to require states to take action with regard to emissions from those power plants, the so-called inside the fence approach. Now, this is building block one, and from a jurisdictional perspective, it doesn't really present any issues. This is kind of what EPA and people in the states have been doing for a long time under other parts of the Clean Air Act. Building blocks 2, 3, and 4, however, bring into play some other folks on the energy regulatory side, and that will require coordination between these regulators and environmental regulators. And people are going to have to talk to each other who have never really talked to each other in the past. Indeed, if and to the extent that EPA has to take more direct actions to ensure compliance, EPA will have to take actions that are not only well outside of the fence, but also well outside of EPA's core areas of expertise and experience. Let me try and explain this, and again, I want to use pictures, not words. And there's some helpful graphics that have been developed by the National Institute of Standards and Technology. These were developed to try to explain the notion of the smart grid and sort of the seven domains of the grid. But I actually think it's a useful thing to look at to try to understand the different domains of the electric grid and sort of who has jurisdiction over what. So this is the big picture. These are the grid broken into the seven domains. Of relevance to what I want to talk about today are four of the domains, and they're at the bottom. That's bulk generation, transmission, distribution, and customers or end users. In turn, there are a number of energy regulators with jurisdiction over various elements within each of these domains. At the state level, there are state utility commissions and there are state planning and permitting authorities, which may or may not be the same entity. And state utility commissions are usually charged by state statute or constitution with rate-making authority over public utilities, and their jurisdiction is typically limited to investor-owned public utilities, though, as you heard, Kentucky is somewhat unique. They have jurisdiction over a wider range of entities, and I'm going to talk about those types of entities in a minute. But being mindful of this limitation is important, and it's why I have included a separate category of what I call self-regulated entities. These include publicly owned utilities, such as municipal utilities and electric cooperatives. Many of these self-regulated entities not only set their own rates, but they also may have their own planning authority. And then at the federal level, the relevant energy regulators are the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, or FERC, the North American Electric Reliability Corporation, or NERC, and to a lesser extent, other federal entities such as the Department of Energy. Under the Federal Power Act, FERC has exclusive rate-making jurisdiction over the transmission and wholesale sale of electric energy in interstate commerce. FERC also has exclusive planning and permitting jurisdiction over hydroelectric generation facilities on navigable waters of the U.S., but it does not have similar type of jurisdiction over electric transmission or generation facilities. That said, it is worth noting that FERC does have some technology forcing and thus planning forcing authority with regard to generation directly under the Public Utility Regulatory Policies Act of 1978, or PURPA, as well as through its rate-making authority under the Federal Power Act. For example, under PURPA, all electric utilities, and that includes those self-regulated entities I had up on the chart, may be obliged to buy power from certain types of qualifying generation facilities, including small renewable energy generation resources, as well as certain types of combined heat and power generation resources. Moreover, under PURPA, FERC has the ability to preempt some state laws to the extent they prohibit or prevent the voluntary coordination of electric utilities designed to obtain the economical use of facilities or resources in an area. Finally, for example, FERC has some backstop siting and permitting authority with respect to transmission facilities that have been designated by the Department of Energy to be within national interest electric transmission corridors. FERC has so far successfully used its rate-making authority under the Federal Power Act with regard to such things as market mechanisms intended to ensure resource generation adequacy, regional transmission planning, also interregional transmission planning, and the integration of renewable energy generation and energy storage resources across large areas of the U.S. Moreover, FERC has used its preemption authority under PURPA to facilitate the integration of a large electric utility into PJM over the strenuous objections of one of its host states. Under the Federal Power Act, FERC and NERC together have jurisdiction over reliability of the bulk electric system, which generally includes transmission and generation facilities at a voltage of 100 kilovolts or more. Now, with this really brief introduction, and I usually spend at least 2 weeks in my class trying to go through all of this stuff, let's look at these different domains and see how the various elements relate to the Clean Power Plan's building blocks and the relevant energy regulator. So let's start with bulk generation. What I've tried to do here is use solid and dotted lines, and you can see everybody's sort of color-coded, and I've tried to indicate through the use of the solid and these dotted or dashed lines that most of the elements in the domain are subject to direct regulation by non-federal actors, while, as I discussed before, the federal government through FERC has exclusive jurisdiction over hydroelectric generation, and then it has more limited jurisdiction over these other types of generation resources through the Federal Power Act or PURPA. Moreover, to the extent that generation is being sold at wholesale, such sales are subject to FERC's exclusive rate-making jurisdiction under the Federal Power Act. Thus, the interface between this domain and the markets domain is largely regulated by FERC. This domain is implicated in building blocks 1, 2, and 3. For building blocks 2 and 3, non-federal energy regulatory entities have jurisdiction over procurement by the entities they regulate, but they have no jurisdiction over the dispatch of generation for sale at wholesale. Moreover, as I mentioned before, FERC has successfully used its rate-making authority under the Federal Power Act to regulate market mechanisms intended to ensure generation resource adequacy. In addition, PURPA does provide for federal regulation of procurement by electric utilities with respect to some types of qualifying facilities. Building Block 2 has been referred to by some, and Commissioner Gardner brought it up, as a form of environmental dispatch, separate and apart from normal economic dispatch. However, if and to the extent that limitations on carbon emissions impose a readily ascertainable cost or operating constraint on a generation resource, they can be reflected in normal economic dispatch. And that has been the case with a number of air pollutants in the RTO context, including carbon emissions under REGI and under California's cap and trade regime. This is transmission. The solid line represents FERC's exclusive jurisdiction over transmission and interstate commerce, including FERC's recently judicially affirmed jurisdiction over regional and interregional planning and cost allocation, while the dashed lines for the non-federal actors represent their jurisdiction over siting and permitting. This domain is implicated in building blocks 2 and 3. More so building block 3, as it calls for expanded lower zero carbon generation and many larger scale, what are known as utility scale, renewable energy generation projects are likely to require long distance transmission facilities to be able to access markets and loads. This is just the distribution domain. The elements of this domain are almost exclusively under the jurisdiction of non-federal regulators, with the exception of distributed resources that are selling at wholesale or distributed generation resources covered under PURPA. This domain is implicated at least in part in building blocks 3 and 4. At least some and perhaps a significant amount of renewable generation, as well as some other resources such as energy storage and demand response, will interconnect at the distribution level. Moreover, some efficiency-related measures, such as automated distribution technologies, will be deployed at the distribution level. And finally, and hopefully this doesn't give you a headache, this particular drawing, this is the customer or end user domain. This domain is almost exclusively under the jurisdiction of non-federal regulators, though this jurisdiction is usually limited, does not go beyond the customer's meter. That said, many non-federal regulators have developed mechanisms to incent various types of investments and behaviors on the customer side of the meter to reduce or shift the time of end-use consumption. Moreover, the jurisdiction of non-federal regulators may be able to reach out to behind-the-meter distributed resources that have effects on the distribution system. Furthermore, as I have mentioned, distributed resources that are selling at wholesale, even if they're behind the meter, but if they're selling at wholesale through the meter, are subject to FERC jurisdiction under the Federal Power Act. And certain types of distributed generation resources also may be subject to federal jurisdiction under PURPA. So what are the takeaways from all this? Well, as you've seen, hopefully in these just few brief pictures, our industry is subject to multi-layered and a complex set of interrelated multi-jurisdictional energy regulators and structures. Implementation of the Clean Power Plan as proposed by EPA will require coordination across these various structures and actors as reflected in state implementation plans or ultimately perhaps federal implementation plans. State environmental and non-federal energy regulators will have to work together in ways that they've never done before. And in turn, in many parts of the country, they'll have to work together with regional bulk power entities such as RTOs, as well as with FERC in ways that they've never done before. Alternatively, if and to the extent that EPA is compelled to take compliance matters into its own hands, it's going to have to figure out ways to work with all these non-federal and federal energy regulators in ways it has never done before. And with that, I'm done.
Thank you, Mike. So I have a few questions, but I'm sure that some of you out there in the audience do as well. So let's just start by opening it up. And while you all think of that and walk to the microphone, Denise will walk to you. I want to take a moment and just recognize some IPI people who have been really instrumental in this. They may have been recognized before, Jack Linke, Jason Schwartz, and Janie Hine, who are sitting here at the table, who have really brought this day together. And I think their leadership has been important in having these presentations come together. So we had a question here. Let's have a round. I see them working every day on our floor, and I know how hard they are at it. So we have a question here, the blue shirt. Perhaps just announce where you're from or your name and where you're from as you ask it.
Bob Wyman, I live in New York City.
Great.
Yeah, a question about Kentucky. You know, even though you guys have a lot of coal plants and things, you're in, as I understand it, you're in the SRTV, the Tennessee Valley subgrid, at least most of the state, right?
Correct.
Yeah. Which means you're mixing.
The two utilities that are not in RTOs are in that. That we have three utilities and one RTO and another utility and another RTO.
Right. So when we look at the carbon intensity of your power, we really shouldn't be looking at just what's in the state, but what's in your entire subgrid, because it all gets mixed together in reality, right?
That's not the way the rule works.
I know that's not the way the rule works. I said we should, not the way we must. But if we did look at it that way, then we come to some fairly interesting conclusions, and that is that you guys in Kentucky have tremendous opportunities to save money for your citizens as well as lower your carbon emissions. And one of the ways you could do that is through electric vehicles and switching to ground source heat pumps. If in Tennessee, given the cost of your electricity and given the carbon intensity, if you were to, Kentucky, if you were to convert your those using oil to electricity with heat pumps, they'd be saving about 73% off their cost of oil. For the people that are using natural gas for heat, they'd be saving about 26%. Any heat pump that was sold in the state that met the government Energy Star regulations of 310% or COP of 3.1, given the carbon intensity of the SRTV grid, would be cleaner than what you have now. So your people, they're being dirtier than they need to be, and they're spending too much money. It seems to me it would make sense that you all ought to be able to have your utility in your state get people cheaper, cleaner power, potentially without even touching your coal plants, and get credit for having done something which would massively improve the economy of your state as well as reduce your emissions. Now the thing is, the reality is that the electricity, as I think in Kentucky, as in most parts of the country, is only one third of the energy that's actually delivered to end use. The remaining two-thirds is almost entirely liquid or gaseous fossil fuels. If we're going to meet our carbon challenges, we've got to get the electricity system from being one-third of delivered energy up to a lot higher, closer to 100%. What are you guys doing in Kentucky? What are you guys doing in Kentucky to give your people, cleaner, cheaper power, as well as working towards generating a lot more electricity, because that's what we're going to need in the future?
There was a lot there to take in, and I'm not sure which parts of it you'd like to.
The political reality is that coal mining is an important industry in the state of Kentucky. We don't just burn coal, we mine coal too. So that's an important economic factor. Kentucky's a poor state. I know you made some statement, I think, in there that by doing all those things you described, the cost of electricity will go down.
No, given current costs, it would be cheaper if your people were using electricity for transportation and heating.
And so let me ask where Kentucky's, ranked 48th, 47th in GDP and income level. So where are we going to be able to afford all the electric vehicles? How many electric vehicles must be purchased into Kentucky to accomplish what you said we should do?
Okay.
Let me just say one thing. I mean, I did say that at the commission we're pushing energy efficiency. We're approving programs. And we're being aggressive with those. Sierra Club intervenes in all our cases. They settle some of them with us. We're moving in the direction that we need to go. But the mining is an important economic driver in the state as a practical matter.
I'm just going to add on to that, if I may. As I listen to your presentation, Commissioner, it sounded to me as if the white paper offered many more options than the legislature currently allows, and that there's a certain amount of frustration, perhaps, or at least limiting that the commission feels and that the environmental cabinet feels as a result of the legislative bill. What sort of work can go on within Kentucky, within the environmental and energy cabinet, in spite of that legislative prohibition? Is there any work stream that is advancing with a broader remit that might be not technically in violation of the legislative act, but it would take a broader view?
Well, I know that Kentucky's going to submit comments, and there's some position that Kentucky shouldn't even submit any comments at all because of the law. So Kentucky's governor has taken the position that we're going to submit comments. At the commission, we have approved a biomass facility. We have approved the conversion of a coal to gas unit. We've approved a new gas and closing of others. I can't talk about existing cases, but we have cases in front of us all the time dealing with things like energy efficiency, and we're pretty aggressive with respect to energy efficiency and recovery of those costs from other consumers.
And just from a jurisdictional perspective, you take your legal counsel from the legislature rather than from the governor's office or from your own legal counsel.
Right. The legislature writes the laws, and we are a regulation. For those of you in academia know, the regulation is a legislative function. And so we're carrying out the mandate of what the legislature tells us.
Great. Thank you. Let's see. Another question. Janie.
Thanks so much to the panelists for sticking it out. Maybe I'll ask two questions that are both pretty short. One is sort of looking backwards, and I'll start there. So in the Clean Power Plan, EPA talks about crediting early actions by the states, and it decides to start in June 2014, and any action the states take after that will be credited towards their 2020 compliance. Just any viewpoints on that? I know there have been criticism sort of both ways with, you know, EPA should have started much earlier. It's unfair to states. Jared Snyder was here earlier talking about New York, and Commissioner Gardner, I'd be curious to hear your views about how Kentucky feels about that as well. So that's my first question. And then the second is just looking forward. Senator Whitehouse talked about tax credits and whether they will be renewed and how that's always a last minute decision. And I'm wondering, when we think about the renewable building block, whether that's really a barrier to driving potentially more emission reductions from that building block, and whether that, yeah, just whether anything can be done, I guess, outside of getting a stronger multi-year tax credit.
No, please.
Okay. So great questions. On the first one, I think the states are all still grappling with how the proposal affects them. And I do think that there are some states that were surprised when the numbers first came out, especially because, you know, some of the early information that was leaking out, you know, was really sort of this point about 30% reduction from 2005, which is more of maybe like the, you know, political optics of how we're doing compared to the targets that we've taken on and discussed internationally. But then when the states looked at the actual base year of 2012, they realized, well, you know, we have a really aggressive target even though we've already done a lot. Some states have argued that there's an anomaly that year, a coal plant was down, you know, or another kind of plant was down for refurbishing. So I think that it's going to be hard to get sort of a unified view, even among the kind of states that we have convened before to give EPA comments. I do think that the states that have already reduced their emissions dramatically are trying to find a way that they can be comfortable, that they can still be quite positive, even if they don't really revisit this notion of early action, which at this point I think would be sort of a zero-sum game unless you're asking, you know, to be more stringent in other places. And so I think that's sort of some of the concern, right? Because if you're a state that's saying, like, back off of me, then you're saying by default to try to make it more stringent somewhere else if you're going to try to keep at least parity from what we have right now. The feast-famine kind of cycle with tax credits is a disincentive for people to invest in. It's frustrating, but, you know, so is a lot that goes on in Washington, so I don't really know that I have a good solution to that.
Just take a slightly different tact, or I guess it's really an add-on to the conversation about action that's early. I think, so one conversation is about 2014 and about things that have been done before the proposal came out. A whole separate set of questions have come up about new actions, like new policies and programs that could come out between 2014 and your 2020 kickoff date. And right now, the way it's the reg is written, you don't, for those new policies and programs, you don't get credit for emission reductions achieved before 2020. And you can get credit for any emission reductions that are produced from those programs 2020 and beyond. And so one of the things that, well, in our industry has been talking about states about a no regrets approach. So we've got these political overtones in our states, but there are a lot of, because of this context that 111D is coming out in, there is opportunity to move forward with new state policies and programs that can start to build up to something that you could put together as a 111D plan and do it now. But one of the things that are, when we talk to state regulators about this issue, is because the crediting only starts to occur after 2020, you're getting some actors in the space saying, I don't want to do that until 2020 so that I can maximize credits. So that's an active conversation on that topic.
And I think that's an important point. I don't want to address your second question because you asked about tax equity. Tax equity is not the answer going forward. Tax equity, when you look in the capital structure of a clean energy project or a renewable project, it's the most expensive piece in the capital structure. And if we're talking about deploying more clean energy going forward, we're going to have to figure out different ways to finance clean energy. And there are certainly things out there that people are doing now. I think we're being very creative. You're seeing securitizations. You're seeing yield co structures. If we had REITs and MLPs, that would be helpful. But the tax equity is not going to be the answer going forward.
Great. Mike, let me just ask you while you're talking. Chair LaFleur has said that FERC, she does not feel as if FERC needs to take a more active role in structuring 111D. Is that a position you agree with, or what's your sense on FERC's role?
Well, and I went very quickly through sort of what FERC does and what the states do. And FERC has rate-making authority, and it's really important what happens. A utility comes to FERC with a rate proposal. FERC's job is to decide whether that rate proposal is just and reasonable and not unduly discriminatory. It's not really up to FERC to say this is how we want people to do things. People propose things, FERC disposes of what people propose. So I think what the chair is saying is consistent with the structure of the Federal Power Act and the way that the commission is supposed to behave under the Federal Power Act. They're really not supposed to be out pushing. Now that said, as I indicated in my remarks, they've done some very creative things in the last 20 years under their rate making authority, but they've always done it where someone's come to them and proposed something, or someone's come and complained about something.
Great. What else do we have from the floor? Yes, right here in the middle. Yeah.
Don Elliott, Yale Law School in Covington and Burling. I wanted to ask a question for anyone on the panel, but perhaps James or Michael will have an answer for me. So one of the things that EPA urges but doesn't require, but one of the things that it says that it credits and encourages states to do is to take measures to keep their existing nuclear online. And in fact, if any of the existing nuclear plants stop producing carbon-free energy, in many states, it would take just a huge amount of additional natural gas or renewables to make up the shortfall. So it's a related question to Michael's presentation about who has authority. What types of authority do the state regulatory utility commissions currently have to keep existing nuclear online? Could they, for example, pay more? The obvious approach would be if a nuclear plant is threatened with closing because of the order of dispatch in a regulated state, one would think that the state might try to keep nuclear online by paying more. But I'm not sure that many states that I'm aware of have that kind of authority, because in the past they've always thought that the EPA rules would go through the environmental regulators and the goals and statutory authority of the local energy regulators is different, and often talks about minimizing the cost to the consumer. So the question is, if you have an existing nuclear plant that you have to keep online for compliance as a practical matter, what kind of authority do the states currently have, or will there have to be legislative changes to give them that kind of authority in order to give economic incentives to nuclear plants that are at risk to stay online?
Do you want to go first?
Sure. I can answer specifically with respect to Kentucky. There is a statute that's been on the book for 20 or 30 years that says that nuclear is basically prohibited in Kentucky.
California, in Kentucky, who knew?
Yeah, exactly. In spite of, you know, the EPRI PRISM a few years ago, which showed that if Kentucky had nuclear, it would actually keep coal more in the mix. And let me answer Janie's question from before about the year, because she specifically directed it to me, was that I think we have no opposition to an averaging, because we agree that 2012 was an anomaly, and I think our position is, you know, average over a three-year period might eliminate that concern.
So, I mean, it's a good question, and I can't speak to individual states as to whether they have the authority under their own statutes or their constitution for a state commission to do this, but in theory, if we were in a state with a vertically integrated utility with captive retail customers, absolutely, assuming the law permitted it, a state commission could subsidize that generation to keep it online. I think the issue is a little more complicated if we're in a restructured state, particularly in a restructured state that's in an RTO, FERC jurisdictional RTO, because we start to have issues about that subsidy. Does it sort of bump up against what FERC's trying to do in terms of keeping a market working, be it an energy market or a capacity market?
Particularly if you have an independent system operating.
Yes. Now, there may be ways to structure that subsidy to get around FERC, but it's a little bit complicated. But there, I think there are ways to do it.
Matt, can you take us inside a little bit the private sector? You're the main industry private sector speaker of the day. And just, you have many children within AAA. The energy efficiency, the digital energy, the utility scale renewables. Are there any conversations among those various clean energy groups that about how the rule is developing and the structure that you can take us inside of?
Sure. Thanks, Jonathan. I think before the rule came out in its proposed form, we worked with a number of our companies to provide recommendations to EPA for a structure. And some of the themes were very consistent with what you're hearing from a number of the folks who've spoken today. We wanted to see flexibility in the state. So all the companies in the different, I mean, you know, in some senses, a number of our companies compete with each other on some level. But across those technologies, there was wide agreement that resources in different states are different. And we want the states to be able to attack this with the resources that they have available. So flexibility for the states to use these use the resources that are available to them was one common theme, a principle for our companies. Another was this electric system approach, you know, deferring all the legal implications to the lawyers in the room. We really wanted to see EPA go beyond the fence line because it's frankly better for the states to do that, because there are a lot of cost-effective resources out there to do this that just aren't available within the fence line. So that was widely shared amongst the companies. And as we go into the compliance plan development process, you know, I mentioned that we're working in a number of states, so we're sitting down with the regulators. You know, one common theme for all of our companies is that we're a lot of this is running through the environmental offices, at least initially. And when we talk to our friends in the commissions, they're actually aware of what we do. When we talk to the environmental regulators, they're used to dealing with sources of emissions. They're not very familiar with technologies that our industry provides. It's a mixed bag. Some are more, but by and large, there's a lack of familiarity. So there's a shared interest in education. How does this stuff work? How do you do evaluation, measurement, and verification? Every meeting I come out of with regulators in the states are, hey, we want more help on EM&V. How do we do this? Because we wanna use energy efficiency, but we gotta trust that it's real, and we don't wanna be recreating the wheel. There's, you know, a lot that's been done in other states, but how does it work for us? So we're finding, again, consistency across our diverse set of children around a number of these issues that I think is helpful from at least what we're hearing back from regulators is it's great to see an industry group across all these technologies have similar perspective around these issues. And it's not, you know, one particular industry saying, hey, I want it structured for me kind of thing.
Okay, I think we have time for maybe one more question from the floor. In the back, there.
So nobody's asked me a question, so I'll do it. I'm Chuck Whalen from Jones Day.
Thanks, Chuck. Hi, Chuck.
What do you project the states are going to do? Do you think that they're all going to submit plans, or do you think that some of them will actually refuse to do that?
That's a good question. I mean, you know, some of them already tried to sue somewhat prematurely, I think, since the rule isn't even final. I do think that there's sort of like a two-track approach that you see going on in some of the states that are somewhat negative at a political level, because, you know, at least in our experience of having these convenings, we've really had a lot of luck dealing with the environment commissioners, the energy commissioners. And I will say, you know, Michael's made a lot of points today about how this rule's requiring people to talk in ways and to people that they haven't before. And I say alleluia to that because, I mean, who thinks, like, yay, silos, you know, yay, like, just doing things the same old way, great idea. And what we're seeing from Reggie and the relationships that had been formed there across these silos, and it's actually carried forward into our transportation work with our transportation climate initiative that we convene in this region that includes the transportation officials, is that that's really spawned some really great conversations that have really helped beyond the confines of this particular rule or discussion. So I think that if we can continue to have constructive conversations and try to enable the staff who are just trying to figure this out to see their way through that, yes, this is achievable, which we're hearing at a lot of our convenings just the same way you heard it from Kentucky. We had the chair of EEI say that at a convening that we did with Lazard in September. So, you know, if the word on the street is that really this is manageable or achievable, then, you know, we'll really see if maybe some of the political rhetoric dies down when people see the final rule and see that they can actually meet it either individually or working with their neighbors in a way that makes sense for them. And so I'm optimistic that it won't be a huge number of states, if any. I mean, for one thing, who really would rather have a federal solution to your state's energy system? I mean, when you can really have this flexibility, the way that it's designed, to build on programs that are often already working really well in the states, very popular programs like renewables and efficiency programs.
If I could just add to that, using Texas as an example, they haven't joined the 12-state suit at this point, but everybody expects that at some point the state will sue. But at the same time, there's planning going on. They recognized, they went through a process with EPA around the some of the original GHG permitting. This is not on the regulatory standard side, but simply permitting of industry for GHG emissions. And the state, you know, basically told EPA to go away. And so EPA said, fine, we're going to give it to the regional office, and they're going to shove the plan down your throat. And eventually industry came to the state regulators and said, you got to fix this because we can't deal with EPA doing this. Because to be quite honest, the regional office is not a permitting office. So we're caught in this limbo land of we can't actually get the permits through for, you know, a whole host of reasons. And we're suffering as a result. Take it over and do it. So I think we're seeing in some states where, you know, you'd expect just hostility, you do see planning happening underneath. You're still going to see the lawsuit, but there's this really interesting undercurrent of planning that's happening. That's not true of all states. There are some states that are simply going the ostrich route, but I'd say that I'm at least hopeful that that's a limited set as we're talking to folks. There are a number of states that are, you know, hostile to the idea that are planning.
And if I could just add, as it was stated earlier, I mean, the utilities are very risk averse. And so over time, you're seeing the utilities not want to put all their eggs in one basket, so to speak, and they're wanting to figure out what they might have to do or want to do in order to comply.
on the silos, you know, it's remarkable to me. There is a cadre, at least among the Reggie states, of between 30 and 50 staff. The commissioners change, but the staff, 30 to 50, who have been working together for about a decade now, and that means being on the telephone with each other 2 to 4 times a week and in in-person meetings 2 to 4 times a year. Both within the states and across the states, and over 10 years, that really creates a capability that can be leveraged at a time like this. I want to ask a simple question of each of you. Sometimes we all imagine that we have more power than we might, and have the ability to change things that we wish we could, that we actually can't. But in the event that you were telebeamed up to EPA headquarters and were asked, had the ability to change one aspect of the rule. I'm curious what that would be, what area of the rule you would focus on that might improve it, and why. And I'll start with you, Mike.
So part of this is what can I get away with under the Clean Air Act, but anything that gets me closer to a price for carbon, so that would probably be if I could get away with going to a mass-based standard, I'd do that. Because again, I think if we know what the price is, the regulatory structures we have in place in the country actually can accommodate that pretty easily. It's the getting to the price. It's going to be the hard part.
Great. Matt?
So it probably breaks down into multiple issues, but I think as EPA has been looking at calculations for advanced energy technologies, what they can contribute and how to credit them, there's still more work to do there. From our industry's perspective, the worst thing that can happen, this reg, if structured properly, should accelerate markets. The worst thing that could happen is that it distorts existing robust markets and slows them down. There are a couple of issues that around crediting, out-of-state crediting issues. In particular, the early action for new programs issue come to mind, where there is some concern about distorting quality. So some clarity around those crediting issues and some improved calculations around what advanced energy technologies are capable of would be a couple of the things.
Other than what my co-panelists have already stated, I think that given that this is the Institute for Public Integrity, Policy Integrity, Institute for Policy Integrity. Excuse me, I apologize. We in the utility business and energy business live with lots of acronyms, and I just don't have this one down yet. So I think that it would be that... As a question of fairness, if a utility has, in recent years, in order to comply with MATS, has spent a ton of money, billions of dollars, in order to do scrubbers and has extended the useful life of the coal facility at this point, the ratepayers should not have to pay those stranded costs.
Yeah, I'm sympathetic with early action, whether it be the companies or the states, but I think I counter to that, and so this might be my two combined, because then they would net out, would be really prioritizing what the capacity is for renewables over the policy instruments that happen to be in place in a state or in the region, in fairness to states that really have led, and to try to bring other states really up to par, given what is the potential for renewables in that state or region.
Okay, great, terrific. Those are great suggestions. So please, I hope you'll all join me in thanking this panel and in congratulating them. Very insightful. And we will now go directly into closing remarks from Professor Rives.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you to the panelists. And thanks to all of you. You've been an amazing audience, and it's quite incredible that now, you know, 8 hours into this, you're all still here, or many of you are still here. So I'm all that stands between you and a beautiful New York City afternoon. So just say how pleased I am that we could have this conversation. I learned a lot. I think there were some very good exchanges. We were very lucky to have Joe Beauvais and Senator Whitehouse as our keynote speakers. And so policy integrity, as I mentioned this morning, is hard at work on a number of issues that are central to the development of this regulatory approach, and we'll continue working on this during the course of this year, and hopefully next year we'll have another conference where we'll sort of discuss the pressing issue of the moment. I just want to end by thanking my colleagues at Policy Integrity. We are a pretty small group. We are eight full-time employees, and then Mike and I sort of chime in from time to time, more than from time to time, and everyone was actually very involved in the planning and the thinking and of the conference, but particular thanks to four people. Janie Hine, our policy director, and Derek Sylvan, our communications director. Jack Linke, one of our legal fellows, and Phoebe Hinton, who I think is out there. You've met her at some point. She's our administrator. So the four of them spent a lot of time planning this conference, and I'm very grateful to them and everyone else participated in the thinking about what we should do. And this is my highest use at this point, which is to remind you that if you want to get CLE credit, you have to go tell Phoebe and sign up for it. Thank you so much for a great day.